Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Shrivya Saloni, a reader from the Department of Periodontics, Inapoya Dental College, Mangalore. So today my topic is about dental identification, a complete antemortem data. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Okay. I think it's okay. All right. So, as you are all aware, millions of lives are lost every year, either due to natural disasters such as earthquakes or due to floods or tsunami, or it could be due to man-made disasters such as terrorism or homicides, suicide bombings. So, following these events, what happens? There are a large number of unidentified individuals, and this is where the role of forensic science comes into play. The identity of a person is every individual's primary right, irrespective of whether they are alive or dead. So how do you identify a person? It could either be due to, you can either do physical identification, you can do fingerprinting, dental records, or your DNA analysis. Now there are certain situations where you cannot use your physical examination or you cannot use fingerprinting, and in such cases it has been proved that dental records are quite reliable. So now importance that is given to identification is done by comparative data analysis. That is, you compare your antemortem data and your postmortem data. Now in India, dentists, they do record data, but it has been found that it lacks uniformity and it lacks comprehensiveness. So this study was basically done to assess the gap in collection, the classification, the compilation, storage and retrieval as and when required following any disaster. Now it has been proven that dental records are quite reliable. For example, if I have to tell you, in 2004 there was a tsunami in Asia and a number of cases were identified using dental records. And also if I have to talk about Mangalore, in 2010 there was a plane crash. So out of the 300 odd passengers that were there, a couple of them were identified using dental records. So dental records are quite important. So the need of the hour right now is that we have to have every individual's detailed dental record kept, including your photographs as well as your radiographs. Now for this study, the samples that were included were patients who walked into the dental clinic or to the OPD, but those who were willing to participate in the study. Therefore, informed consent was taken from the patient prior. So a thorough clinical examination was done, following which a detailed case history was recorded. Now after this, we recorded the intraoral and the extraoral photographs. Now the extraoral photographs that were taken with the patient standing against a background, and photographs were taken both in the frontal and in the lateral view. And in the frontal position, again, photographs were taken with the patient in a relaxed position as well as in a smiling position. Intraorally, the photographs of the maxilla were taken using indirect vision, and the mandible and the surrounding structures were taken using direct vision. Along with this, intraorally, we recorded the occlusion, both the right and left occlusion. Now these photographs, a soft copy was recorded and it was put into the database. Now following this, we recorded the lip prints. Now for the lip prints, we used a cellophane strip, and after taking the print, we pasted it onto an A4 size sheet paper. It was scanned and then again put into the database. We also recorded the palatal rugae. So what we did, we took impressions of the maxilla and the mandible, and once the impressions were recorded, the casts were poured using dental stone and the palatal rugae was marked on the cast. Now why have we chosen the palatal rugae? Because they are unique to an individual and therefore they could be used as one of the points for verification. And this is also scanned and recorded in the database. Finally, we took the radiographs, we opted for an OPG, and the soft copy of the same was recorded. Now, once all this data was collected, it was compiled and put into the database, and this information is not shared with anyone except in case the patient party, that is relatives of the patient, they request it following any emergency or disaster that has occurred, but only if they have the authorizing legal letter, we are allowed to share it with them. The other scenario where we can share it is if it is requested by the legal authorities in case of emergencies. Now, as I mentioned, these are all the data that you need to collect for a complete antemortem data. And as you can see, it's quite simple. It's easy to do. And despite the fact that it is time consuming, since you have to collect all this, these few simple additions in the data collection, it could save a lot of time for professionals who are working during an emergency or a disaster in order to attain identification. And also, it could lessen the anguish of the families of the missing individuals. Thank you.